Have you ever looked at your Pilot G2 and just said to yourself, if only these guys made a pen that was 700 times more expensive? What? Just me? For the uninitiated, yes, Pilot and Namiki are in fact part of the same overall umbrella. And while I don't own a G2 now, that gel pen used to be my bread and butter in junior high and high school. So I find it somewhat funny that in my adult years, one of the more budget luxury pens in their line is now my go-to for almost everything. That's right, this $700 pen is considered a budget option in the Nippon line. So what is it about this pen that made me pass up some good Pelican offerings to pick it up? Well, let's see if I can convince you over the next few minutes that I didn't make a mistake. Oh, I should probably mention that today we are taking a look at the Namiki Nippon Art Crane and Turtle with a medium nib. You know, kind of important things. One of the first things about this box is how much it reminds me of the Nakaya unboxing experience, complete with the little pattern on the lid of the box. The other similarities kind of require you to ignore the pen label on the back, and as we open it up, the Namiki stamp on the inner box itself. But I swear, the outer and inner packaging are just so close. One feature I like about this unboxing experience, though, is this little flap on the side. I don't like the experience that some pen companies make you go through of having to flip the box over and shake the pen out, so this modification is a godsend. Before we get into the box, let's take a look at the paperwork that comes along with it. First up is the carry use guide, which I will choose not to read in the finest of traditions. Below that is the product registration card, which, now that I look at it, I'm kind of 60 days overdue for getting this put in. So yeah, I guess there's that. And under that, we have the Namiki specific care and use guide. This covers their fountain pens, capless pens, and rollerball pens. It also goes into small detail of how to clean the lacquered pens. Now, to be fair, I did actually double check this book just to make sure I wasn't ruining a $700 purchase. Sometimes you do need to read the instructions. So now we get to look at what's inside the box. Or maybe better yet, let's look at the box itself. You know, speaking of this box, I'm pretty sure that this is the same wood that Nakaya used. I didn't know what the wood was at the time, but one of my viewers suggested that it's most likely Kiri. So for now, we're just gonna go with that. If I'm wrong, feel free to correct me down in the comments. Moving on though, as we open up this box, we're greeted with foam. Yes, that's it, just foam. I mean, that completely makes this pen worth it to me. So video over, am I right? Yeah, no. I definitely appreciate those small things, and to be honest, I would like to see more pen companies doing that, especially with how many things can go wrong during shipping. And at these price points, you want your pen protected. Below that, we have the Namiki blue cartridge that is probably never going to get used. And then we have the pen itself, resting inside a plastic sleeve and cradled in a velvet bed. The velvet actually feels like it has non-substantial backing holding it, so the addition of the foam is actually making me feel a little better about the packaging. Notice though, unlike a $700 Nakaya purchase, we don't have a kimono in here. And if I had to pick one thing about this whole unboxing that's, you know, kind of slightly disappointing, the lack of kimono would definitely be it. Looking more closely at the pen though, this is one of the biggest reasons that I bought it. The crane and turtle motif is applied to the pen using a Hira Makai technique. The contrast of color on black lacquer helps each design pop from the background, and it's then brought over the top with the addition of gold and silver powder. It's the final layers of lacquer that seal in the artwork, and that helps add polish and flair to these pens. Pair that with the gold trim that we have here on the cap, and as well under the cap, we do have a 14 karat number 10 nib, which is an amazing nib, by the way. And the section, even though it's short, is quite comfortable because of the way they do the lacquer on top of the threads. Also, last note before we look at the size comparison, included with the pen that you didn't see in the box is a Con 70 converter. I have a love-hate relationship with Con 70s. This particular one has been very well behaved and I have no complaints. A couple others though, like the one that came with my 845, I actually had to get a replacement for that one 3 times. So take it with a grain of salt, you're either gonna love it or hate it. As you can see here though, It is currently inked up, and it's currently inked up with its sixth converter full of diamine oxblood. That just happens to be my pairing of choice for this particular pen. So let's go ahead, get the pen put back together, and then take a look at this pen side by side with the Sailor 1911 Large Stormy Seas. Now, when we've got them both capped, the lengths are pretty close to each other, with the 1911 coming in at 140.2 millimeters, and the Nippon Art coming in at 141.8 millimeters. Weight-wise, though, the Nippon Art does come in 8 grams heavier at 32 grams. Uncapped, the Nippon is now 6 millimeters longer than the 1911 at 129.4 millimeters. But the weight difference is now only 3 grams in the Nippon Art's direction, with it coming in at 19 grams. The sections are also pretty similar here, with the 1911 Large coming in at 18.5 millimeters for the thread to flange length, with the Nippon Art sitting at 19.5 millimeters. And section width also keeps the 1 millimeter difference, with the 1911 coming in at 10.5 millimeters and the Namiki coming in at 9.5 millimeters in diameter. So if you find the 1911 Large to be a pretty good size pen for your hands, then the Namiki will be a pretty good fit for you as well. This pen has been my primary go-to now for the last half year, and on Tomoe, I have a hard time finding a better combination. This 14K gold number 10 nib just glides across the page, and the feed works amazing when paired with diamine oxblood. From day one, I've not had any issues with skipping or hard starting. As an experiment, I even left the pen uncapped for about 3 hours, came back, and was able to get right back to writing. That's actually a test I like to do with new pens and inks just to see what I can get away with. And I'm sure a lot of us have done that by accident at least once or twice, let alone on purpose. Now, moving back over to the feel for a few moments, this section is actually very comfortable, and this is one of those pens where I would feel comfortable using it for a long writing session. In fact, I have once or twice where this pen has been used for a 2-hour writing session with no hand fatigue or finger issues from the threads. And I guess these things are all points that you would hope for if you were spending $700 on a pen. And they should be. Unfortunately, that isn't always the case with some brands. So for Namiki to provide a good writing experience out of the box that requires no nib work whatsoever and actually makes me want to use this pen, I call that a win. This is one of those pens that I would make the decision to buy time and time again. So there you have my look at the Namiki Nippon Art Crane and Turtle. If you like this video, then hit that thumbs up, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, and if you want to support the channel, get early releases of Two Guys Zero Planners, or early releases of these reviews, or heck, even just want to support my dogs, then there's a Patreon link down below for that. Till the next video, don't drink the ink.